Bellator 172. Make time to watch this card because you want to watch Fedor Emelianenko, man. Some of you people, there's new fans that haven't seen him fight. There's old school fans that are going to get goosebumps when the guy walks out. If you've never been to a live Fedor fight, this may be his last one. You never know. I mean, he's retired before. I would say get out and do it. It's definitely a bucket list thing. Justin McCully, he's going to come on the show. Justin's actually going to be here, I think, in a couple of weeks. So he may stop by and actually co-host the show with us. Chris Weidman will be on the show. He's going to talk about the road back to the title. Road back to the title for him goes through Gegard Mousasi. It's going to be a really good fight. Gegard is a guy that's been around the sport for a long time, but I think he just finally started to find his groove about a year and a half ago. So, I don't know. We got to find out. Is Chris Weidman going to be able to bounce back from some of these losses? I think he's got it in him. But Gegard Mousasi, you never get a poor performance from the guy. So, I think that's one of the fights I'm most excited about coming up here in the future. What else? Today is the day that you guys pick the music. It's Thursday. So, if you haven't done so already, let Danny know what you want to hear today. Anything goes. It could be 80s, 90s, 2000s.
Anything goes as long as we have it in the system. Let's be honest.
God, Danny, if you do that one more time. Every day, I ask Danny if there's like a song I want to hear or something. I go, Danny, can you play this blank, right? And he'll always tell me if I have it in the system. Every time, every song. It doesn't matter how pop, like, it could be Michael Jackson Thriller, and he'll still say, if I have it in the system. I know that
because
if you
it
don't
doesn't
have it in the system, it's not going to magically
It doesn't have
appear.
Certain songs that I would think that, like,
I'm not gonna
would be popular
you,
enough
I'm
to
not
have.
I'm going to stab you for it, man. If you don't have it, you don't have it.
You might, I don't
but
know.
But he gives me this disclaimer every time. If we have
I was, that time I wasn't even trying to do it to you. I was just saying in general, like, it's within reason.
It's kind of annoying to look up music sometimes for Danny because in their system, you type in the name of the song or you type in the name of the artist and whoever's inputting that stuff, if they're lazy, it could really come down to just one little word or an apostrophe in the wrong spot and it just won't show up. Like, I think today we were looking for Depeche Mode, I Just Can't Get Enough, and somebody put it down as Just Can't Get Enough. So it took Danny a while to finally find it, but it can come down to just stupid little things like that.
It does come down to apostrophes, too. Like, I remember looking for something, I can't remember what it was, but the first word had an apostrophe in it, and I had to end up looking it up by the band and scrolling through it, and there was only one version of it, and it didn't have the apostrophe when it was supposed to, or vice versa. I can't remember. Mm-hmm.
I am going to put up the number here for you guys. Start getting in that queue. 866-522-2846. Been killing it on calls lately. And they've been a lot of new callers and a lot of good calls. Thank you very much to the people who went on iTunes and dropped us a little rate and review. That was pretty cool. Heard some good stuff in there. So thank you very much. That does help us out on the back end. There's just this weird, stupid algorithm that doesn't really make much sense, but we've never really been much about telling people to go in there and rate and review, and we found out that that's actually a very important component to putting your podcast up towards the top where people can see. And so I would say for the amount of reviews that are on there, it's pretty impressive. So now that we're asking you guys to do it, I'm hoping a lot of you guys will come out and actually do it. Don't be that
Up
guy that
minute.
Just sits around and goes, hey, somebody will do it. Well, I'll get to it later. Just fucking do it. It takes like 10 seconds.
What's funny, I don't know if you've ever said this, but just going through the reviews over the years, like the first one that popped up was, I guess, one from like you and one from George because it was talking about tag radio mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So just kind of looking at the span of years that the reviews and stuff are, it's kind of interesting to kind of just go through and see the what who rated and who left a message and stuff.
Yeah, what they're talking about. My favorite caller is Dirty South. And you're just like, what?
Up in 30.
That was a long time ago. All right, guys. We're going to shut it off for now. And we will be live here in a couple seconds.
All right, guys. Coming up at 10. Stand by.
This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMAjunkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position because the descent is going to be a little bit bumpy.
All right, Junkie Nation, it's time to roll, baby, on MMAjunkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Go. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long, we rollin'! Yes!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape. No escape. Through the vast frontier of cyberspace and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and Sirius XM satellite radio technology. MMA Junkie Radio. Commence transmission. Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world. Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Go.
From the fight capital of the world, inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Racing Sportsbook, you are listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show. The @MMA Junkie Radio Show. That's actually our handle on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook. It's facebook.com/MMAJunkieRadio. Now, you're watching us on our big page, official MMA Junkie, so facebook.com/official MMA Junkie, as well as youtube.com/MMA Junkie Video. I'm George, and that's Goes. We'll be hosting today's show like we have the past almost 2,400 over the past almost 10 years. Danny's back east handling the producing duties. What's up, everybody? How you doing, Goes?
What up? How's everybody doing? How you doing, Danny?
Good. How about you?
I'm doing great.
Today we're going to talk to Chris Weidman, former UFC middleweight. He's coming in around 2:45 p.m. Eastern, 11:45 a.m. Pacific. He's going to be on Kevin James's new show.
Kevin Can Wait.
Kevin Can't
or
Wait.
Or Can Wait.
Is it Kevin Can Wait, yeah. Kevin Can Wait on Monday. So we'll talk to him a little bit about that guest appearance, as well as his preparations for Gegard Mousasi, and I'm sure what he would call his road back to the title. We'll also talk to Justin McCully, good friend of the show, former UFC heavyweight. I'm talking like early, late 90s. Even pre-Zuffa, McCully was beginning his career. And he fought during the SEG area in MMA and during the Zuffa era for the UFC. And he's now a founder and promoter of Mid-Pac Championships in Hawaii. They have a fight card on the 17th, which is tomorrow. So we'll talk to him about that. We'll also talk to Cheick Kongo, who is going to be fighting Ole Thompson at Bellator 172 on Saturday. That fight card headlined by Fedor Emelianenko and Mitt Mitrione. We may also have one more surprise guest. I think I talked about it yesterday. And then when we were in the process of locking it in, we just tripped over some time zones and things like that. But if you heard the show yesterday, then you know who I'm talking about. It's going to be a fun show, and the first hour is wide open for the most part, with the exception of Congo beginning things at 1:30 p.m. Eastern, 10:30 a.m. Pacific. So you can call in. We can talk to you about anything you want in the sport of mixed martial arts, 866-522-2846. We'll have a good run of calls before Congo. Talk to Congo, take a commercial, and then come back with more calls, 866-522-2846. All right, Goes, what jumps out at you? I feel like a lot of times I bring the ball up court and I start the offense and off we go. But let's say this time
you're bringing up the ball. What would you like to talk about?
Well, I want to talk about watching that trailer for Woodley and Wonder Boy. Mm-hmm. And it's a trailer that Woodley didn't like, right? He felt like it was more slewed in the direction of Stephen Wonder Boy Thompson.
The one for 209?
Yeah.
I didn't hear his complaint about that.
Yeah, he had a tweet about it as well. I'll pull that up right now. But I don't know, man. I watched it and...
That's not going to go good with a lot of the public that already labels him a complainer.
I didn't really see it.
You didn't see... Okay, well, it's obviously something that is posted publicly, so we can stream it. Can you make it happen?
I think I can, yeah.
All right, let's see it.
Give me a second.
Yeah. In the meantime, I'll do some Facebook shout-outs. A lot of you start getting in there early. You know the show doesn't start till 10:03 a.m. Pacific time, 1:03 p.m. Eastern. So a lot of you are in there, and you're asking questions, and we turn on the cameras a little bit early.
Here.
So shout-out to Tony Polidio, Daniel Schiller. He says Bisping's running from everybody. Chasm saying Amir King Kong. That's right. That might be our surprise guest. Chasm also says he can't make up his mind. Should you listen to us or Jermaine DiRandami does have a media conference call today. Mm-hmm. She didn't have a chance to talk to the media after her fight, and since then it's just been a whirlwind for her. And she's receiving a lot of criticism because on the one hand, she said she needed to get hand surgery and she probably won't be defending that title anytime soon. And then by the time she got back to Holland, she was putting out a new video, a new message that said, I want a rematch with Holly Holm because a lot of people feel Holly won it. In the meantime, many are interpreting that as running from Cyborg, inconsistency there with as far as you know what she wants to do. I'll give her a pass on what you feel like after a fight compared to what you really are, you know? Because you can be seen by a doctor, and a doctor can clear you and say, no, you're good to go, you know?
Yeah,
that happened with
before.
Max Holloway. Yeah, we pointed to Max Holloway on Monday's show and said he was already calling Jose Aldo for UFC 208 in Brooklyn, which would have happened by now. They would have merged the titles, by the way. And then by the time he got back to the locker room, he realized, wait a minute, my ankle's swelling up. I can't do this. So I give the athletes a bit of a pass there.
Happened with Johnny Hendricks and John Fitch.
But I have to.
Lasted 7 seconds.
With who?
With John Fitch. Remember when he laid out John Fitch? Then it turned out we asked him, you know, who do you want next? He goes, actually, I hurt my hand with that one punch.
Oh, yeah, correct. And then, but I also have to ride with the fans that say, well, this is what it looks like. I won't defend the athlete there because I'm with you. I'm a fan too, man. And I felt like that sounded a bit bizarre. Like, you know, this whole thing was built kind of around Cyborg. Mm-hmm. Then she came up on her troubles. Now it looks like she may be getting out of her troubles. So you had a good feeling that whoever wins this fight is taking on Cyborg next. So when we hear the hand, okay, well, that hand better be injured because if Cyborg comes out, we want you versus Cyborg. And then when you come out and say, hey, it turns out the hand ain't so bad after him, but I want home, a lot of people are going to interpret it as running from Cyborg, and I think I'm one of them.
So this is the tweet. It says, let me know when you guys do my version of the extended promo, and I'll retweet it. His came out great. So this is the it's titled here on MMAjunkie.com. Here's the UFC 209's extended preview, the one champ Tyron Woodley initially wasn't happy
about. How long does it take?
It's pretty long, but I mean, I think I could play like a little bit. And
yeah, let's play a little bit.
Gist of it. So let me.
So right there, he's standing there, and it looks like he's more to the forefront with his belt. It's titled Woodley versus Thompson. Yeah, we got
Ladies
it.
Ladies and gentlemen, this contest has been judged a majority draw.
The fight was ridiculous. It was the fight of the night. You do it again.
There has to be a second fight. There's got to be a winner to this. You know, for me, if
so
I was
they start
the champion,
with Thompson, is he taking that wrong?
I wouldn't be happy with that performance.
Maybe. I would say maybe
as
you
a champion,
start with
it
the
would
champ.
Be like, hey, I'm taking this belt as a participation trophy. You know, there was no real winner to this fight. So glad we're doing it again, man. It's my second shot to prove to the UFC and the fans.
Been 30 seconds. We can hang in there a little bit more.
Sometimes you got to be careful what you ask for. He thinks he wants to fight me. He survived. He survived the last fight. This time, he won't make it out the octagon.
Oh, huge bomb! Okay, first highlight goes to Woodley.
We learned a lot of things. Tyron played a very smart game. And we were.
But it's Thompson's dad talking as you're watching it.
Who's not just his dad, but one of the coaching team.
He's the most creative striker in our division. I don't think he expected that. You know, he took the first round. He was it.
I was a little bit surprised on how I had the pure power advantage, especially on the ground.
Hard shots to the midsection.
Now he landed one to the face. Big elbow. Two
okay,
elbows.
We're about, what, a
he
minute in?
Won the first and fourth round.
All right, let's stop for now. I didn't see anything egregious a minute and 20 seconds in. Other than if Woodley just feels like, why didn't they start with him? But to be fair, we'll finish it out maybe through the show or maybe during commercials and we'll give more feedback. I don't have a problem. Like I said, the first highlight went to him. Mm-hmm. He's featured first there on what will probably be the poster and everything. You know, any images that are out there. So, yeah.
The one thing
he didn't clarify, right?
I've seen a little bit more of it.
All right.
And the story that seems to be told to me kind of comes off as how maybe Woodley was robbed. Thompson was maybe robbed of a victory.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe that's the problem he may have had. So, I don't know.
Is that you struggling to make a point on
a
behalf
bit.
Of Woodley?
I wish I didn't see the title.
Or did you kick back and go, what is he talking about? Like,
No, I sat down and I watched it.
Okay.
But I wish I hadn't seen the title because now I think I'm looking for things.
Right.
As we're just a regular goes that opens up a video. I don't know if I would have said, this is weird. Like the other thing the other day, right? The Goldberg being omitted.
Okay.
When you don't know about it, you may not catch it.
Right.
But once I tell you, it's pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Right? It's one of those situations.
Yeah. To be fair, I guess I'll have to see it all. But, again, going off Tyron in the last few months, I know a lot of people just are not getting on. They're not in the Tyron Woodley business. They don't want to become fans of his. They, you know, I think he wants to be a beloved champion. I don't think he's ever said, I want to be a heel or anything like that.
Well, I don't think he's to the point where he's a heel or people dislike him because he's a great fighter to watch. He's a great human being. He's a great person.
Yes.
Gives great interviews, but he's just been vocal about certain things that he doesn't like. And a lot of it I can't blame him on. And some of it, like this video, I go, oh, I don't know if you really have a case here, but some of the other stuff I could see.
Very well. All right. 866-522-2846. We have a call from the UK, so maybe I'll jump on the callers a little bit sooner than I usually do, just because you got to respect anyone who is lobbing a call our way and paying, more fees or whatever is involved with an overseas call. Who knows? We can call Mexico now and Canada for free. Did you know that? A lot of the mobile carriers.
Are you sure?
I believe so.
Canada for free?
I believe so. That's why I threw that caveat out. I believe that's what I'm hearing now is now these calls, part of new packages are that you can call and just, you know, there's no longer the 011 and this and that. And you can now make those calls within at least those two countries. And who knows, it'll be worldwide. The other day, Mom made an error and she called Peru for 16 minutes. Now, back in the day, that type of mistake could have been about a $100 to $500 bill. I'm talking like 30 years ago, like before these long distance carriers that allow you to call for, you know, very cheap. And it was only $43 because I saw it and I said, So she got a call from Peru and I think she said, I'll call you back, because I looked at the phone bill and it looked like something where maybe the call dropped or maybe she fell. She'll take the burden usually of issuing the call from our end, because over there they do get hammered a little bit worse. So I could see something like that. And then she called the same number that called her and I think she forgot to go to her long distance carrier, which is and incredible savings. So we talked about that.
Anybody who remembers making long distance calls 30 years ago, they probably resemble what you're used to seeing when you watch a prison movie and they're calling home.
Mm-hmm.
They just get to the point right away.
Mm-hmm.
People weren't messing around with, hey, how you doing?
Right. It's quick. It's rushed.
Mm-hmm.
It's rushed. Like there's you're in a room and there's a killer in the next room. Listen, but the other thing is, even further to that, you may not know this. Before, you used to call the operator and ask for a line to make the call. Did you know that? I think by the time you were born, it was just pick up the phone and go through a sequence of numbers.
Yeah, I think that's
But even when I was little, we had to ask for a line to call for your mother's days, birthdays, things like that. And then they would issue you a line. And you had to do it early because Mother's Day was busy. Collect calls, yeah. All right, so let's get to these calls. Mohammed from the UK will start things off. What's up, Mohammed?
Not much. What's your opinion on GSP's return?
You know, we talked about this a little yesterday. I guess, in the end, if I just had to use one word, I think when I read it, I felt excitement. Now, when Ford can't call in, it was either Ford or someone else, one of our callers, and he started remembering of some of the cycles I've been through with GSP and some of his fights. Yeah, I guess there was times where I was, not the most excited at the result. Maybe it was just due to his dominance or whatever. But, no, man, I kind of miss the guy. I felt like he left the sport with something still there to give. I know he's good for business, not just for MMAjunkie, but also for Junkie, traffic and continuing to build the sport and us running a business.
I like it. The one thing that I can always point out to with GSP is he's that one guy that I felt did it right. He walked away from the sport at the right time. People weren't tapping him on the shoulder going, I think at the time you should leave. You've taken too many KOs.
Right.
So I feel bad about that. Hopefully he doesn't end up going out that route. Mm-hmm. But what I really want to see is the contract. Because the contract is something stupid, like some of the things that Conor McGregor's getting. Man, you're just going to see more and more fighters going, I want to get paid. I'm holding out. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. And we're the
which
fans
they're entitled
suffer.
To do, but they you are. Better be one of those guys
but
that
you
can gotta pull
But you've
got to
be realistic
in.
As well.
Right. What do you think about it, Muhammad?
I think that it's perfect time for him to come back, considering Bisping's a champion and Tyron Woodley's a champion. It's perfect time for him to come back, take some titles, make some money, and get back to where he was before he left and cement his legacy as one of the greatest of all time. Coming at the age he's at now and dominating the sport once again.
Who do you want to see him fight?
Personally, I think that him asking for more money, I think that's something he should have done because before he left it.
Oh,
the Reebok deal is going to put him in a lot of troubles with all of his sponsors. So I think it was good that he asked for him and he stood for himself.
Who did you say you want him to face, by the way?
I want him to personally face Michael Bisping, as I think my boy Bisping needs that final pay there.
Okay.
I just think that needs to happen.
You know
all
what?
Right, buddy. Thank you very much Muhammad, for the call.
Oh, is he still on there?
Oh, no. I moved
I
want
to know where in the UK he's from.
Okay.
The one fight that I've always wanted to see, and it's not going to make sense right now, but I just feel like it's a good matchup, would be him and Robbie Lawler.
Mm-hmm.
Because even if he gets Robbie Lawler down, Robbie Lawler is good off his back at nullifying the guy on top.
Give me your top three GSP. If they call you and say, all right, Big Mouth, you make the play. We signed him. What's next for GSP? But give me an order
what makes
of
sense or
one,
what
two,
I just
three.
See.
Just what you want as a fan.
What I want as a fan. As a fan, I would want to see him fight Robbie Lawler because I think that's a great matchup.
Okay.
I think the Tyron Woodley matchup would be good too.
Or
and
the
I
winner,
like,
Woodley Thompson, yeah.
Yeah, actually, I like them both because I think they would both be fun.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe not so much Thompson because if he does get him down, I don't see hope for Thompson really getting
And what
back
about
up.
The business decision?
Business decision, you bring him back. I do everything I can possibly do. I give him a matchup that I think he can win.
Mm-hmm.
And then I set it up because I want him to fight Conor.
One thing Dana's made very clear when he responded to people that said, hey, why'd you give Ronda Nunes? Why didn't you give her a warm-up? He goes, I'm not going down that road. You go down that route. In the UFC, you'll fight the best. Now, I don't believe he's always subscribed to that. I think there's been some convenient fights for other fighters. But only a sharp eye can catch that. That being the hardcores that host this show. The hardcores that are watching, the hardcores that go to other websites, you know, the 200,000 or 500,000 of us that kind of pay for most these pay-per-views, you know. Because even though I say 500,000, there's people that are at each other's house. So the first 200,000, 300,000 pay-per-views, I think, are bought by all the same hardcores. And those are the ones that just kind of like, okay, whatever. But if he's on ESPN, if he's on Libertard Show or something else, there's millions of others that are consuming it going, really? You guys have always had the toughest matchups?
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so I believe that GSP will come back into a title fight. I as much as
directly.
Some people want the Diaz matchup or the Anderson matchup, and it's not like I would hate those. I think they're going to bring them back. I think their thing at WMEIMG is titles. So I think it's become a two-horse race between the winner of Woodley and Thompson, or right now we can just say Woodley because he's the champ, or Bisping. However, I think what's going to trip things up is that Bisping just got that bone tossed to him with the Hendo matchup in Manchester. Whereas, I think I think they're going to stick to Romero there. Unless GSP were to say, okay, I signed, but I'm not ready till the end of the year, then maybe Bisping and Romero can settle that and then figure things out later in the year. But I believe that it'll be the winner of Woodley and Thompson. I think they'll want to keep him there and see if he's still it at 170 pounds.
Do you think it matters?
So I think Woodley's
going to
be the winner
of
the sweepstakes if he gets past Thompson.
Do you think it matters who comes out of that fight? Is there one guy that they're hoping?
No. I think every time Woodley wins, he's going to get more popular, and he'll become more of a draw. Hate him or love him, that's just the way it's going to work. But I think Thompson has that look, you know, where he can make those types of strides. Oh, why am I messing around here? I mean, he's a good-looking white dude, you know, and the UFC's had good luck with that, with marketing that type of guy because of the audience that watches it. So I don't even understand why I'm tiptoeing around it. But I say he's marketable. I think you all know what I mean. But I think he could be – I think with either side, they win as long as GSP's involved. All right, back to the phone lines. Mike from Jersey. What's up, Mike?
What's up, guys?
Mike, can I make a suggestion?
Yeah, sure.
Can you just be Jersey Mike?
Ooh, that'd be a good one.
Right, like the subs?
Yeah, I mean, I could do that. But only for you guys. About the GSP thing, I heard he's going to be at in Vegas March 4th for the fight.
Okay.
And he is going to be getting the winner of Woodley and Wonderboy. But really, it kind of sucks for Maya. But I mean, what's going to happen with him then? Is he going to fight the loser of that match, or is he wait even longer now? He's been on the shelf since, what, the Condit fight in, was that September or August?
Mm-hmm. Maya's got to be like an ostrich with his head just buried in his hand. What do I got to do?
Right. But what's cost Maya, guys, is that Maya, for one, is an expert in a field a portion of mixed martial arts that not many people want to watch, and that's the ground. You know, what's the ground? It's mostly wrestling and jiu-jitsu. And even though he's dominant, he did go through a stretch where he wasn't getting finishes. The finishes, people love him. Once you get a finish, I think people are like, yeah, jiu-jitsu all the way, wrestling all the way, or whatever. But for a while there, he was going through some decisions, and then there was some lethargic third or fifth rounds, you know, that type of sequence. And then, okay, let's just say you're that guy. Well, you know what? You got to be pretty polarizing on the mic to make up for that, kind of like how Ben Askren is. You know, Ben Askren, they call him a blanket, but man, he's pretty – if I hear that Ben Askren did an interview, I'm usually click and play. I mean, he usually has something colorful to say. And then Maya is just a respectful martial artist guy, but there's an audience for that, but it's not big. So I think that's just what's going to happen. He's just going to get passed over by all these other instances that come up within his division, one being the all-time greatest coming by, or another one being an exciting draw, I guess, by the champ and an exciting fighter. He's just, yeah, I mean, I don't want to say he's brought it on himself, but he kind of has.
If the UFC is going to benefit from a GSP pay-per-view, no matter what, they're going to get those views. Wouldn't they, you think, try to talk GSP into having a fight with Maya? Because I feel like they could talk him into it, saying, you know, Maya's not too much of a striker. He doesn't have to worry about that all that much. And,
That's not a bad point.
And then the winner gets a title.
But I just think the way I've seen WME IMG roll lately, I just think they bring him back for a title fight. So I'm just kind of going off the precedents that they've kind of set these last 8 months that they've been.
Because the worst thing that can happen is their cash money guy gets taken out, right?
That's like, let's say Woodley and Thompson wasn't happening in about 3 weeks. And let's just say they just set the date for something like we're all doing Holloway or fighting. Then if GSP's healthy, I could see them saying Maya and GSP on the same card. That way if the champ or the challenger falls out, you elevate GSP. You know, I know Maya would go for it. I'm pretty sure GSP would go for it. But I think at this point it's just too close. We wait 3 weeks and we bring the guy in the octagon and make up a huge announcement and sell a bunch of pay-per-views in the summer sometime.
Do you guys think
– hell, I might be wrong. If Holloway and all those timelines wrong, and let's say that fight wasn't set and GSP decides that, hey, they may take apart the Thompson-Woodley matchup and go, sorry, he's back. It's Woodley versus GSP.
Prime U.S. GSP versus those four guys that we mentioned. Woodley, Thompson, Maya, and I mentioned Robbie Lawler earlier.
Yeah.
I don't think he can get through that.
In all fact, four?
I would say
– fuck, no, I don't think he can get through all
we're
four.
We're talking about prime
but
GSP.
But gun to the head – I think he can beat each one individually.
Prime GSP,
with proper camps.
I think, would go 2-2. That's how much better guys are now.
Prime GSP.
Prime GSP.
Oh, wow.
2-2.
Gun to the head.
Gun to the head.
There's two of those guys that you'll put.
A lot of those guys are nightmares, George.
I don't know, man. I've seen Woodley be flat against McDonald. I've seen Maya be flat against Shields. I've seen Robbie.
I think Robbie Lawler decapitates
be flat against the first. Well, not flat against the first Hendricks, but he just didn't look as good as some of the other fights. And who was the last one? Thompson.
Awkward style.
Yeah. But you know, just not having the ability to take, defend the takedown. But finish up, Mike. What else?
No, I just think it's really unfortunate for Maya because outside of a title fight or a fight with GSP, I don't see a benefit for him to fight anybody else. So it's just really unfortunate he has to wait around. That's all I have.
I agree, brother. Yeah, I agree, man. I hate to bury the guy because he's a nice guy. He does the interviews when we ask him to. But there's an equation right now that works in mixed martial arts, whether you like it or not. And it's stirring the pot. You have to do it or you get bypassed. All right, let's go to Marco in Waco, Texas. What's up, Marco?
Marco from Waco Roar, GSP Talk Day 2, man. Hey, I don't care about who GSP, where GSP fights are going to be a big business. But I would love to have been a fly in the wall and hear about these conversations, especially because if you follow the news, you know, Stephen Curry, you know, the Golden State Warriors have an issue with Under Armour. Under Armour, you know, is not doing good on the stock market. The stock kind of sort of went down. They have issues with the CEO, you know. Stephen Curry is a big deal. He's having issues with this brand. You know, this brand represents GSP. I wonder how much money is USC and even Reebok throwing to GSP to maybe dump Under Armour, because that whole sticking issue of the whole contract was the promotion of this other brand. They were paying like, what, $250,000 a month or some stuff like that? They were some ridiculous amount of money, like $3 million a year. So I wonder how that freaking ended up. I speculate, guys. We don't let you guys carry on this time.
See you, Marco.
Yeah, you know, I don't know much about the Steph Curry, the Golden State Warriors, and the Under Armour thing, but I have heard, aside from that, about that, that it's not going too well for those guys.
Didn't they become number two after Nike?
No.
Yeah. I heard they bypassed Adidas and became number two at one point.
Under Armour?
Yeah. I couldn't believe it, too, when I read it. We'll look it up during the commercial. But I read that, and I was like, wow, I always thought it was Adidas, Nike in the last 50 years or whatever their existence has been, with Nike obviously being the number one.
Maybe because of
at least the last 30 since
stuff,
Jordan.
Right?
I don't know. I didn't, you know, it was an article. I read a little bit, and I go, oh, how about that? And then that's it. But I thought I read that. Now I'm going to try and pull it up because I think I've seen it at least two or three times. That said, Adidas must be making a comeback because the money they're paying Manchester alone, that was the most lucrative deal in any sport.
So who wouldn't want to be involved with that franchise, Jordan?
That's a good point. By the way, I thought I saw Gegard Mousasi. I thought I saw him here, and then I stared at the guy just until he finally turned around and almost gave me like, what the hell are you looking at type of thing? But it really looked like him. All right, we'll be right back after this break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93.
Go ahead.
So on the Facebook chat, I'm getting asked by Danny Creighton, with the popularity of Connor and the return of GSP, do you think they could do Connor numbers? Them two together? Hell yeah. They could. I think the UFC would make a mistake by booking GSP against Connor.
Out of the gate, yeah, maybe.
Yeah. The more I think about it, GSP Diaz isn't a bad play.
He's one of them.
But they love these titles so much that's why I think it's not going to happen. If Diaz can beat him, you can immediately go, Diaz, you're next in line for a title, you know? And if it only leaves them at 1-1, so they could still do their trilogy.
Nick
and
Diaz.
If GSP smashes, then, yeah, it kind of hurts what you could have done with Diaz, but GSP's back. See, those guys have heat, you know what I mean?
The whole team, because really, like, I have a clip of GSP.
Fuck the fucking Diaz brothers! Fuck them all!
Yeah.
I buried those cockroaches!
It sounds like them, too. It sounds like them, too. So, yeah. There's so many directions to go with it. That's for sure. Bark at the Moon, Ozzy Osbourne. That's a request maybe for music. Trooper by Iron Maiden. For What It's Worth by Placebo. Don't Fear the Reaper by BOC. That's coming in from Tony Palladio.
I got it.
Robert
got
Rodriguez says, Chasm. The problem with his attention is that it takes away from light abilities and makes him look more like a complainer. The complainer review. Okay, these guys are talking amongst themselves. Sounds like about maybe Woodley. Dean Desper, what's up? How you doing, brother? He looks happy as ever, doesn't he?
Yeah.
In Facebook, he posted stuff with him and his lady. Yeah, good for Dean. Lewis Jennings, Amir Khan, to call Connor out. Wouldn't last 2 minutes. Ooh. Yeah, I mean, in boxing, I don't think you could question that Khan would beat Connor.
Back in 30.
I have no doubt Floyd will. In MMA, it changes. On the street, it changes. I'll give Connor that respect for sure. Daniel Narcisse, looking fly. All right,
guys. Coming back in 10.
Okay.
He's there and ready to go.
Okay, cool.
Yep.
Thank
he's there ready to go.
Charm, compassion, common sense. These guys have none of that. You listen to them, so you're no better. I am awesome, though. They are Gorgeous George and Goes.
We're going to jump right to it. Our next guest is ready to go. Our first guest of the day, it's Cheick Kongo, who faces Ollie Thompson at Bellator 172 on Saturday. This starts at the main card starts at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 Pacific, coming to you live from the SAP Center in San Jose, California. Hello, Cheick. How you doing?
I'm doing well.
Awesome, man. Well, thanks for joining us again here on MMA Junkie Radio. It's always a pleasure to have you on. I imagine you're in San Jose by now, getting ready for this fight. You never have to cut weight, I imagine. So you have one of the easier type of fight weeks, right? It's more about relaxation and just being ready for Saturday?
Yes, as usual.
Have you ever thought of packing on just a little bit more weight, just to maybe, you know, have like a 20-pound advantage over some of the guys that are a little bit smaller, or do you just like being fit like you are?
Well, I'm always being like this. You know, sometimes, you know, I get in weight and the build the fight, so I do drop naturally, so I don't know why. So I think it's probably about the stress or just the way to be conditioned, you know, and be focused and tense on the fight. So. Mm-hmm.
What is fat for you anyway? Like, you can only see 6 abs instead of 8? I mean, seriously, you're pretty much always in shape, right?
Honestly, for this camp, you know, I was out of shape like crazy, because usually I used to train, like, you know, usually to stay in shape, could be conditioned, so. And so this one I did, but I was so busy also on the business side. Mm-hmm. So I get weight, I get belly, I get everything, and it was just like, oh, it's gonna be awful. Mm-hmm. But I'm not in the shape like I used to be, and so I need a lot of prep to read of this and be who I am.
Cheick Kongo, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He fights Ollie Thompson at Bellator 172 on Saturday. Main card starts at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific on Spike. Cheick, yesterday we were at the UFC gym and we ran into Mehdi Baghdad, a French fighter like yourself, and we had a good conversation about just how many great athletes there are in France. First of all, we talked about you and Francis Ngannou and Mehdi, of course, Carl Amasu. A lot of French fighters are really starting to show up on the scene. You've been here for a while. And then we talked about so many great footballers as well. But overall, would you say there's even more French fighters that we don't know about that are going to, you know, that are going to be hitting all these promotions soon?
Hopefully, yes. So the thing is, you know, it's been a while. You know, I didn't take also the database from France. But I know, you know, many guys, you know, are still waiting for the moment, you know, to rise up, you know, on the center and be crazy for that. So, yes, we have a lot. You know, the MMA tank in France is huge. And even if the sport used to be banned, you know, for the promotion, but it's huge. And everybody used to be anything with that, you know, and learning the sport, you know, increase, you know, the show, you know, the value of what that means for them, you know, but it's big. And the thing because the sport over there is prohibited, you know, but you have a lot of followers, a lot.
All right, let me send it over to Goz here. He's got a couple questions for you.
Cheick, how has your body held up throughout the years? Because I watched a couple of your fights in preparation for this fight, breaking it down, and you look like you're getting better and better. And you look in more shape than you've ever been. It's almost like age does not exist for you. Can you tell us, like, how is your body held up?
You know what, the thing is, just to say, so, and I used to repeat that probably the last 2 years, but I used to be injured, you know, when I fought Travis Brown in the UFC in London. And I completely broke my spinal, my vertebrae. I broke my vertebrae, L4-L5, but for sure, when I fought him, you know, I didn't know what was the case. So, and that's funny because I was supposed to be here in the United States, do some medical check and just find out what it was. Nobody used to say what it was because they didn't see anything. That's what we had. And I went back to France for sure after the fight, and I wanted to make sure, you know, it was moving with and clear. And as of trouble, so I find out after, you know, I broke my vertebrae, so for sure I used to get some damage on my shoulders. So I was supposed to be retired, you know, and get surgery, spending 5 years, you know, between surgery and rehab to get surgery on those three spots.
Wow.
And I used to be treated and healed with the French medical device, you know, called Winback. And I decided to, I spent 7 months, in that 7-8 months. After that, I started the best fight ever, you know, UFC against Palmieri. So when I did this fight, I just spent a few months, to come back, you know, to the camp and stuff. So for some reason, it was just a benediction. It was a blessing, you know, to be allowed to fight again, you know, and be away from any surgery, any cuts. And from that time, you know, I decided to promote that brand. Because saved my life, honestly. That thing saved my life like crazy. And all the time when I used to get injured, like severely injured, and being away from the camp or whatever, you know, honestly, it takes me at least two, three weeks to come back in shape, even sometimes less than that. You know, for any physical issue, you know, and that's the reason. That's the reason, you know, right now I'm crossing the years, you know, pretty good, you know, in shape and not being worried about my detention. Because that device has me a lot. I've been on recovery, insurance, pain, you know, and even aesthetics. So, and what I was saying before, just like, yeah, I look good. It was pretty tough, you know, for my camp, but also I need the device many people used to say, oh, he's not fair, or he's a liar, but that's what I did. And today, you know, even today, that's my thing. I never goes away anywhere, you know, especially when I'm training, without the device. The device following me everywhere. I promote that, you know, so, as much as I can get in the future, because people used to get some good stuff to hear and help people in jobs, you know. But with that thing, it's like, and the time is better than everything. I'm there in the press room, you know, on, and the good thing with this is many fighters, you know, especially from South California, around Orange County, LA, use that device. When I used to drop one of the devices at Kessler, it also find out, you know, interesting. And many guys used to get, you know, with bad issues, used to stop by and get that. And send the effect, you know. So I would say many names, but, you know, I'm not there to say, okay, you know, thanks to me or whatever, but, you know, it's not a fucking lie. So the thing is really good. And even around the world, that brand is to show the value, because even here in America, we used to get a lot of testimonial from many people around the world. So.
Man, wow. That's some crazy stuff. Anything that involves a spine, sheesh, Harry. Now, you're 25-10-2 overall, 7-2 in Bellator. And, you know, it's funny because in the main event, we have Mitrione versus Fedor. You fought Mitrione before. You've beaten Mitrione. You basically fought everybody. But I'll tell you what, man, if they can make the winner of – if you get past Thompson and Fedor gets past Mitrione, I sure would love to see you two guys dance down the road.
Thank you. Yeah, honestly, that's the kind of stuff, you know, that people would love to expect, you know.
Yeah.
And especially also for me, the thing is, my concern, you know, just try to keep the rank high, you know, to be positive, and you know, just be clever, you know, don't be in a rush, but just be clever in the fight and keep doing what I'm doing, because for sure with the age, you know, no matter what, one day people will say, oh, you know what, he's that being. You know, he's like, so whatever. But, you know, just for my own person, I just want to achieve, you know, what I have to achieve. So be victorious no matter what, you know, and it's been crazy, you know, the door I do on my way. So you're going to be, honestly, you're going to be fine. You're going to be exciting also, because, as you said, you know, I used to fight everybody, you know, and especially for the long term, I have to fight. You know, in that business, you know, it would be great to keep going probably a few more, you know, before to be retired. But you know, I still have gas, you know, and still enjoy the fight. And yeah, honestly, I can keep going like this for probably two more years. You know.
All right. At least. Well, we're in. Consider us in. If you want to keep fighting, we'll keep watching. Thank you very much for the time on Fight Week. And, folks, follow him on Twitter, @KongoForReal. Cheick Kongo getting down against Ollie Thompson on Saturday at Bellator 172. Spike has you covered, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 Pacific. Thank you, Cheick. As always, we appreciate it. And can't wait to see your fight on Saturday.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, take care.
Bye.
See you, mate. That's Cheick Kongo. Again, follow him on Twitter, @KongoForReal. And we're going to take our last commercial right now of the first hour. When we come back, we'll blast through some calls. 866-522-2846.
That's how it goes, I guess.
idiot. Yeah, you. Can you please tap that rather large fellow on the shoulder and tell him it's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes? Thank you.
Hey, Goes.
Yeah?
I don't want to get all morbid on you, but I kind of compiled a list of fighters that we either knew, connected somehow, or just covered that have passed away. I can't believe how big this list is.
MMA?
Yeah, and it all started because we just got past the one-year anniversary of the loss of Kevin Randleman. And I was thinking, wow, last year was quite a few deaths, actually. So I went back and I just started kind of listing, yeah, MMA-related or somehow associated with Junkie. But check this out. Blasovina, remember him from the Hard Rock? Corey Hill, broken leg, tough five. Emmanuel Yarbrough, UFC 1, right?
Two,
okay. Also a Yokozuna at one point. Evan Tanner, great fighter for the UFC, middleweight, light heavyweight. Gilbert Aldana, probably didn't have the heights of some of these other guys, but he was a UFC heavyweight. And he, I think about him when I visit Dan Stupp because we go in a lake. And in previous years, we weren't wearing life preservers. And it's a pretty clean and safe lake, but it does go deep. And there was a sign that said, I think I told you this, and you reacted to it. 150 people have died in this lake.
What?
Yeah. And now, I mean, the lake didn't open 2 years ago, Goes. I mean, it's been there since the existence of the United States, I guess.
Yeah, but I don't think so they were keeping records.
Since they've tracked it, it says 150 people have died. Not all the people that died, none of them were wearing a life preserver. So it was just their way of reminding you.
All of them? None of them were wearing
None of them were wearing a life preserver, yeah.
Oh, wow.
So it was their way of reminding you, hey, look, stuff can happen. And so since then, no matter what, I consider myself a pretty strong swimmer, but even when we were going, it was just funner to float, just have it on, not have to worry about it, because you just never know what can pull you down. But Gilbert Aldana died, I believe he was trying to save his kid, right? He was a UFC heavyweight. It was in Arizona.
Yeah.
I think something fell. I thought it was his kid. I hate to categorize a kid as something, but I'm foggy on the details. But, yeah, I believe that's what happened. And in that process, he died. But then wouldn't the kid have died? So I don't know what happened. I'll have to look it up. I was compiling the list, not going through everything else. Here's one. Gurum Guganishvili. Now, you may go, who? But do you remember that tall guy from Georgia? He was in our studio. He was an M1 heavyweight. Real tough, real tall guy. I remember he was tall more than anything. But, I mean, well put together. Mm-hmm. He had a really good record. He wound up losing a key fight that probably could have got him to that either Bellator. No, because Alexi's never been in our studio. That could have either gotten him to Bellator or the UFC at some point, just because at some point you can't look away from like a record like that. Mm-hmm. But there's probably got to be a picture because we usually take a picture with everyone that's ever been through the studio. But I thought you might remember him. But when I show him to you, you'll go, oh, yeah, that guy. Jeremy Williams, more of a SoCal guy, friends with Joker. You know, that team took a lot of hits as far as people they knew they were associated with that passed away. Joe Camacho, remember him? Jordan Parsons, the hit and run. Kevin Randleman, of course. Kevin Rozier, first UFC, right? Yeah. Kimbo Slice, last year. Hyan Gracie.
Mm-hmm.
Ryan Jimmo. Sean O'Hare. Shane Del Rosario from SoCal, like us. And then these are people kind of associated with MMA that I think we didn't cover as fighters, but were fighters, just not in that capacity when they passed away. Helio Gracie, who we got to meet in L.A., Mauricio Zingano, who actually came with – did he come with Cat?
No.
Cat no, came, he by came herself, with
– But he came with Ed and somebody else.
He came with our buddy, the striking coach, Mark – wait, the one that dressed like a rockabilly.
Oh.
Why am I blanking on that?
Oh, my God. Wait.
Vegas guy for so many years. Now he's in Colorado.
Oh, my God. It's Brad's favorite, Brad from Buffalo's favorite dude.
Yeah, Mark. Wait.
Yeah.
Mark?
Mark?
I don't know.
What the fuck?
I know. You're supposed to back me up.
The hyena.
These. Yes. Mark the hyena. What? Someone help
Beecher.
On Facebook. Beach. Yeah. I think he came with him. And so Cat wasn't here that day. Cat did come on another day, but by then Mauricio had taken his life tragically. Sean Tompkins, Charles Lewis, and then even more personal to us, Rick Budo, Eddie Constantine, and Giovanni, was it Buenas Noches or Noche Buenas?
No, something like that, yeah.
Yeah, was his last name. So these were listeners or friends of ours in one way. And am I missing anybody?
Justin Levins.
I think I did say him. Yeah, he's here. Oh, sorry, I skipped the line. After Parsons, Josh Saman. Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is a big list.
Now, yeah, I'll leave that as that. I'll take Gerald from L.A., and then I'll tell you where all this came from. Gerald from L.A., what's up, buddy?
Hey, how you guys doing? I just want to touch base back on the Holly Holm card. You know, just thinking about it after our talk on Monday, I really don't know if that was worthy of a pay-per-view card, and I'll tell you why. I think that, you know, Dana White's got to put more thought into developing, you know, a new division, for example. Just who are the contenders? You know, people, whoever wins this fight, they're saying Cyborg, Cyborg. But the point is to take some time and develop some contenders and get people's interest in division instead of having one titleist win the title and saying, who's next? Is it the big name? That's why, you know, you need to compare boxing and MMA. MMA is more geared towards entertainment. And when boxing, you develop these fighters, they're ranked, and the rankings mean something. But with this new female division, there's no contenders in there except for Cyborg. So I think they need to come in, sign more fighters, develop the division, get people interested in it. And then I think they'll have more choices of fights to put together to keep people engaged in who, because I don't know who Randami was. Everybody knows Cyborg. So I know it's about selling tickets and pay-per-views. I don't know what kind of numbers they did, but to pay $60 for a Holly Holm headliner, no, that wasn't my interest. I wouldn't spend my money on that.
All right, buddy.
Even having Anderson Silva on the card, he's past his prime, I think. So
they were supposed to have Aldo and Holloway. I think the intention was to stack the card. It didn't work out, and then at the end they were faced with what do? They have taken a pay-per-view and turned it into a Fox Sports 1 card in the past, but them going in Brooklyn, I still felt like they thought they could make a pop. So it's unfortunate it didn't work out that way. Now, listen, I'm up against the clock here in the first hour. If you want to hang in there with us, I'll take you to start off the second hour. Otherwise, thank you very much for the call, Gerald, from L.A. All right, folks, we're going to take this break. When we come back after the sports update, we'll talk to Justin McCully, and if Gerald hangs in, then we'll talk to him. I'm going to keep on the run. All right, this song's not hitting its stride. How was it? It's okay, but there's usually a point where it drops and I can tell everybody we're coming back, and he's just kind of singing lyric after lyric after lyric. So here we go.
I don't mean to disrespect the strokes.
But
that's not the strokes. That was just the chorus. You just passed right over.
Oh, was it? Oh, but it wasn't catchy enough. Like, there's usually a drop in the song where you just go, "You are listening to," and it just Danny fades it out nicely.
Uh-huh.
And this one, the guy just kept saying, "This and that, this and that, this and that, and this and that, this and that, this and that, this and that."
Can I play what we were gonna do?
This and that.
Yeah. Can we play what we were gonna play?
Sure.
Can I come back with what we're? Okay, we'll start over.
Here we go. Initially, what we were gonna do. All
right, guys, coming back.
All right. All right. Cool. Turn it down for just a second. Obviously, you guys know I have nothing to do with music. I'm not musically inclined, but watch how this song will go. Watch. Just not raise it again. Open up the limit. Past the point of no return. Reach the top, but still you gotta learn how to keep it. Second hour of the MMA Junkie Radio Show. See, he left that opening for me, the singer.
But you went just as far as if you would have gone a little bit
further. I know, but I know what the song is, so I knew it was coming, whereas the song you played, I didn't know when it was coming, so that I just had to push eject.
You heard that song? Danger Mouse?
I may have, but I just don't remember it. All right, we're going to bring back Gerald from L.A., and then Danny will lock up, hopefully, Justin McCauley. They're like 3 hours behind over there in Hawaii. Hopefully he's awake. Gerald, what's up, buddy?
Hey, listen, first of all, I like to say I like your taste in music. I love Scarface. Anytime you play that, it's all good.
Pues quien no? We all love it. Hey, listen, I want to play. Let's go with your call. I thought about your call a lot here. I'm going to play the UFC side to your complaints, all right? So this is just kind of like the devil's advocate role or whatever. I hear your complaints as far as what you're saying, but if you like, look back at the last 6 months. I think the UFC gave us some really, really good stack cards. And if there's a certain card that we're willing to pay $60 for, when they give us the better ones, we don't sit there and go, "That was so good. Here's 80. Where I'm sending an extra 40. Here's 100. We don't. Some of them just stack up nicer than others. I really feel like their intent is to try and maybe make them all up to a certain par, and then some of them will be special. 200. 205, first time in New York. And then last weekend, this coming up weekend, and 2 weeks ago, was all on free TV. So I think the UFC, part of the UFC side is when they do come up short, whether it's an injury or it's a booking they couldn't put together, I think they just kind of like hope their fans forgive them a little bit. They'll never publicly say, "We got you. We got you for that 60. That was only a $40 card." They're never going to say that.
Their own way.
Huh?
They do in their
they
own
might, way. Because Dana's like so honest. Yeah. Dana's so honest. But I don't think they'll really make a big statement out of it. And so I think what they just try and say is, "Hey, give us a pass, man. You know, we really came strong on some of these cards where we were, like, doubling up and tripling up titles." And, like, Habib and Michael Johnson did not need to be on New York. It was so stacked you could have put it on Toronto, and they would have taken it. And they said, "Fuck it! We're going nuts! New York!" You know, and I think TJ and – wait, no, not TJ and a Sun South. That was something ridiculous on the undercard where you're like, "Wow, that could actually headline a Fox Sports 1 card." So that's all I'll say, Gerald, is and with them actually intending to have Holloway and Aldo, I think the intent was there. It just didn't work out. They pulled Lewis off there because of what was happening in Nova Scotia with Junior Dos Santos. He was going to fight Struve. So there was a trickle effect that just kind of hurt a couple cards. Now, going forward, if Bisping and Romero holds up in Dallas, you can tell – they're headed back to stacking cards because they've already set up Verdum and Rothwell, JDS and on Struve, and then there's really no need for Bisping Romero card. And I'm hearing maybe even Joanna might be on that one. So you can tell they're headed back there. It's just the roster was used up at the end of 2016. Therefore, 2017 was just going to start off slow no matter what.
Yeah, I mean, I come from a background of boxing where, you know, TVKO used to come out. Used to look at the quality fights, you know, the Tyson Holyfield fight, you know, and used to get a lot of value for your money. Then Mayweather started building himself up. The mm-hmm. price started going up and up. So I look at it from a quality point of view. Now, with the UFC, you know, they're starting to lose some of their superstars. Ronda Rousey is on a two-fight losing streak. That's why they signed St. Pierre, and McGregor's holding out. I mean, these fighters are starting to get a lot more leverage and starting to get higher paydays. If you look at Rousey's last fight, she got $3 million. Prior to that, she got $100,000. So, you know, they have more and more leverage these days and calling numbers. And look at McGregor holding out. He's not even announcing a fight. So I just wanted to talk about that as well as the Lewis Brown fight coming up this weekend. You know, it's interesting enough that Travis Brown and Ronda Rousey, when they got together, they both started hitting losing streaks. And I wondered, you know, I've been thinking about their coaching, Edmund and Glendale. And the way I saw Rousey fight her last match was very, very disappointing. She stood straight up. Her head was straight up. She had no body movement. She didn't even, you know, do the typical beginning boxing stance, keep her jab out, move her body up and down. She stood up there like a board. And Nunez just tagged her. I mean, it was like a punching bag for her. And so with going back to Travis Brown, I'm wondering, you know, with having the same type of coach, he's been avoiding the questions of whether, you know, Edmund's going to have an effect on his upcoming fight. I like Lewis by knockout. Do you guys know what the odds on this fight is?
I don't think they're up there
They're not posted here, so I'd have to look them up. I will try and get to them before the show's over. Yeah, hopefully you stick around and listen. But we have to move on to Justin McCauley. You know, Edmund, look, I think whoever coached Ronda in that fight against Nunes, I think the result would have been the same. I think you have to tear down a little bit of what she's learned in the last few years and add to her judo. And so I think it'd be a work in progress to get her to catch up to some of the girls that surpassed her. So she She got lit up so early that I don't know what coach would have told her. Move her head this way, that way. She's just got some old bad habits. You know, once Amanda tagged her, that was it, man. It was going to just be a downfall from that. But thanks, Gerald, for the call. We got to move on, buddy. Good call, good discussion. All right, so our friend Justin McCauley surprised us this week, Goz. He's in a ball game there of promoting fights.
Yeah, it's been something he's been wanting to do for a while.
Championships taking place out there in Hawaii. Oh, guys got it so easy, man. They're in paradise out there.
It's going to be here soon.
We struggle with either cold, extreme cold, or extreme hot here in Las Vegas. We get like, I think there's part of March and part of October that's nice, but that's only 2 out of 12 months. They got it nice every day.
We get a lot of rain, too.
Yeah. All right, joining us now is Justin McCauley. What's up, Justin? How you doing?
What's up, brothers? Everything's doing very well. And, yes, I am here in paradise, but it's been rainy and pretty nasty over here for the past few days just to make you feel a little bit better, even though the sun's shining right now. And it's a beautiful morning here in Honolulu. Getting ready for mid-pack this weekend. You know, we got a pretty cool card, our first time out. And stepping into the promotion games is an interesting deal. But, you know, I like to be inside the cage rather than on the other side. But as age provides, you know, we have to move on in life and do the right thing. So trying to put a platform together for some young athletes of Polynesia and Hawaii to be able to climb the ladder and get off the islands and over there to the big stage. So a lot of fun. Had a lot of fun putting it together. Scotty Junk's my partner in the thing, and we've been marching right along, trying to, you know, put the platform together so it's a long-lasting approach to giving these guys a consistent avenue to compete multiple times per year and put their resumes together and prove themselves worthy of the next level. So it's a lot of fun. We're looking forward to our first show Saturday night. We got Friday night. We got Alan Belcher coming out, and Anthony Noy is going to be there. And so we're looking forward. Ruben Asato, I think, is going to show up, and
And we got a Daichi Abe, number two guy on the in the 170-pound division out of Pancras in Japan. He's going to fight an old schooler from Oahu, Bryson Kamaka. And so, we're looking forward to it. It's going to be a great time. What's going on with you guys? What's happening? Everything well?
Yeah, we're good. Now, let me bring in your partner, Scott. This is Scott Young, the heavyweight, former heavyweight.
Yeah, heavyweight.
Awesome.
Yep.
All right, so Danny, can you bring him in? Because we can conference him in. Looks like Scott's on hold. Hello, Scott. How you doing?
He's up.
I'm good. How you guys doing?
Doing great, man. Thanks for joining us here on MMA Junkie Radio. So, we got briefed there nicely by Justin. It looks like, is this a two-man team? You two are co-founders, co-promoters of Mid-Pac Championships?
Oh, yeah, definitely. But the blessing that I received by being with Justin on this was I always wanted to help out in our state and in Hawaii, but Justin's education always gets me. I love listening to the guy talk. He's been doing it since 1992. I mean, I didn't start till late 2005. So it's one of those things where I love the sport, I love where it's going, and I love my islands. But now it's to the point where I have the best partner because everything that the guy brings to the table is stellar. The guy's ideas, the guy's direction, everything is awesome. It's really been a blessing.
We talking about the same Justin?
Thanks, I appreciate that, bro.
Justin's solid, man. We've known for him for years. You're in good hands, and he's also quality behind the mic. So I'm excited for you guys. So this is the inaugural show. It takes place tomorrow night. And tell us, please, about the main event. Let's start with that. Who are the fighters you're featuring at the top of the bill?
Well, we got Daichi Abe out of Japan, Pancras guy. He's really, really tough. Hiroshi Manashi, an old schooler who trained some of the legends of the sport, is training him and bringing him along. And so we're looking forward to a great performance out of him. We've seen him in the gym. He's really, really strong for a 170-pounder. He's got an amazing butterfly guard. His judo's it's top level. And his striking's really, really good, too. He's crisp. But he's got Bryson Kamaka on the other end of the cage. And Bryson's got really good hands. He's a cagey veteran. He's had upward of 80 fights. I mean, the guy's been fighting since he was a young boy here on the islands. And so, he's matured now. He took a little break from the game, and he's ready to get back at it. And he's taken on a tough opponent, but he's in good spirits. He's really positive about it, and he signed the contract as soon as it was put on the table by Scott. Scott threw the contract at him, and he couldn't sign it fast enough. And Scott can tell you probably a little bit more about Bryson and his background and what he brings to the table, but it's going to be a barn burner. We're looking forward to this one.
So tell us a little bit more about that, Scott.
But Bryson is when he was a young boy, he was fighting. That dude was fighting four fights a month, and he was just getting thrown to the wolves, and he was really, really putting it on himself. And at one point, he was taking fights on 2 days' notice and stuff like that, and he did it all the way through his 20s. So he won a lot and he lost a lot because of just bad decisions. And now he's 31. He's a family man. He's found God. He's changed his life around, and you can see it. And now he's fighting at a weight to where he's comfortable. He looks thick now. At 170, he looks really good. Before, he was cutting to 45 and 55. And he's one of those guys, when you shake his hand, wow, this guy's got some big hands and some big knuckles. You know what I mean? So he he has heavy hands. His last fight was 2 years ago. He took that on a couple of days' notice. He went out there and he knocked a guy out that was trying to get to the UFC. And so it's one of those things where Bryson is a journeyman. And now it's one of those stories that I want him to succeed. I want him to do well because he's one of those guys that he put in the years of just winning and losing, winning and losing. And you build character that way. And then now the fact that he gets to put it all back out there in front of his fans and his friends in Hawaii in a main event against the number two guy coming from Japan, that's awesome. That's he wins this. I'm happy for him. I'm stoked. It's bro, hell yeah. When I talk to him, it's his mindset. You know when you talk to a fighter before a fight and their mind is right? That's how I felt when he signed the paperwork. It was one of those things where if this fight was online and I could bet on it, I would bet on Bryson.
We are on the line here with former UFC heavyweight Scott Junk and Justin McCully. They are co-promoters, co-founder, of Mid-Pac Championships, short for Mid-Pacific Championships. They have a card tomorrow night on the 17th at the Philcom Center in Waiapahu, Hawaii. Doors open at 8 p.m. And look at the ticket prices. Damn, who can't afford this? 25 gets you in the door. 33 makes you a VIP. So check it out. For more info, you can call either one of these two gentlemen, 714-788-8692. 808-232-3770 for more information for tickets. Ghost, what do you have for Justin and Scott?
Scott, you've been immersed in MMA in Hawaii for a long time now. This promotion, how would you say it differs from what we've seen in the past there?
We are the new face of MMA in Hawaii. We are the fighters that the fighters deserve. We're the only promotion that's going to be putting guys in, getting them full medical, getting them taken care of. They're not going to sign any waivers when they fight for our company. What I've seen so many times with these promotions come out, and these guys come to fight, and at the weigh-ins, they go, here's a waiver you have to sign. If you get hurt, we don't have any responsibility. I think that's bullshit, and I've seen it happen too many times. So that was the first thing me and Justin talked about, taking care of the guys first. So therefore, every fighter on our show will be covered by our insurance company. We're the ones that are going to take care of the fighters. We're gonna actually put their stats out there. So after every fight, they're going to be recognized as they had a fight. There's fights on my record that never showed up because promotions that I fought for never set them in after the fight. We're going to have video on everybody. We're going to have something for them to offer when they want to go to the next level. We're that new face. We're the company that the fighters needed.
I love it. I'm fired up now, George.
I do, and I want to add to something. I wanted to wait for the perfect time to add this. You know, Scott said there's some fights that nobody knows about. There's one fight I know about of Scott Junk's. It still gives me nightmares. I think I told this to Scott when he was with The Ultimate Fighter. We might have had him on the show, but we have a new audience. That was years ago. But, Scott, when you fought Hideki Tadao, I was front row. I was behind Ryan Bennett and Phil Baroni. I think they were calling the fights that night. And that elbow you dropped, man, was vicious. I've never seen a skull kind of like cave in from an elbow. So if anybody ever asks me, what's the hardest elbow? Or maybe even the hardest strike you've ever seen in my life, that one's it. You remember that, obviously, right, Scott?
Oh, yeah. I felt horrible after the fight. During the fight, it was awesome. But after watching him getting taken on a stretcher with his head in a sling and getting rushed to the hospital, that dude never fought again. And that really did haunt me for a while after that. I was like, in the action, it's like, I'm going for the kill. But when that kind of stuff happens to a guy afterwards, it's like, damn, like, that really did haunt me. But that, I landed three of those elbows, and that's why the referees that we hire are the best referees in the state. We don't hire guys that don't know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. It's that referee should have stepped in after the first elbow, but I landed two more after that, and then I got off on my own, and then the referee stepped in. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those things where we need – that's our company is here to protect the fighters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I actually saw Larry Landless about a year ago, and we talked about that, and he did admit that he was late on the call. Owned up, you know, at least in that conversation we had. And then another guy that was there was Bruce Buffer. He was actually the announcer that night as well, goes. And everybody had that same reaction, like, stop it! Just because, oh, man, you know, it, just to see the skull do that.
Yeah.
So, you know, him saying, I believe him and Justin saying, we're going to protect the fighters. I mean, because you can honestly point to their fighter involvement, their careers, and that's one that I don't know what Hideki Tadao, you know, what Rumble on the Rock ever did for him or whatever. But that scores a lot of points for me that they're so upfront with protecting the fighters and looking out for the fighters throughout their, you know, their participation in mid-pack championships.
I think that's something you get when you have guys that were fighters that did go through all these type of things, make these type of decisions. It's good that that's happening.
Correct.
Hey guys, now, Justin, can you tell us, like, I know this is home base. Will the show travel amongst the islands? Where will be kind of home base for you guys?
Sure. Well, Oahu's our home base, and we're definitely going to branch out to all of Greater Polynesia, really. We're looking to go to Tahiti, Fiji, you know, Guam, all around. We're going to start here in Oahu, branch out to Maui, Kauai, and then continue on through Polynesia. And there really is no limit. Anything that touches the Pacific, we want to try to hit eventually. Start, you know, crawling before you can walk and walking before you can run. So we got a cool, calm, slow approach to this. You know, like we said, we're in it for the long term, and it's about the athletes and about bringing on these young athletes and giving them an opportunity and a home to create themselves, their character, and their product. And like we said, we want to protect them
and you know, give the amateurs a chance to prove themselves and then come on and make their pro debuts with us and give the local pros who haven't had that chance and that look and that consistency that, you know, the market hasn't provided over here for some time. We want to lend that to them. And so that's really our approach. And so, yeah, we're going to branch this out as wide as we can. And hopefully we get to, you know, bring you guys along with some of that and travel together. It'd be amazing.
And Scott and Justin, you know, anybody that's in Hawaii, obviously you've made it very affordable for them to go out there and watch these fights. 25 gets you in the door, 33 VIP. What about for anybody that's listening that wants to watch themselves some fights? Will there be a stream available, or is that something you'll tackle down the road?
Well, this one here, we're going to put in the can. This is our pilot show. You know, we're starting small. We want to iron out all the bugs, make sure we work out all the details. Mm-hmm. So this is more of a live event, closed caption for the people who are here on the islands. And then once this is put in the can, edited down, then we're going to put it out for people to see. And our next event and the events, you know, coming forth after that will all be broadcast. We can't exactly tell you who our deal's with yet, but we got a big announcement coming real soon on that.
That'll work. All right, fellas. Well, thanks for joining us here on MMA Junkie Radio. Appreciate the time. Good luck tomorrow night with Mid-Pacific Championships.
I want to say something real quick just based on what your last guy was saying with Rhonda and Trav and the whole nine yards. And we all know Edmund's the problem. I mean, come on, let's just call a spade a spade. That guy shouldn't be letting the building, let alone coaching a professional athlete. And in Rhonda's defense, poor grapplers, you know, people get scared of your grappling and they try to avoid going to the ground with you. You end up getting into a stand-up probably at a car dealership somewhere in Los Angeles, and you think the boxing coach that could have been victories, or, you know, could have been at least been more competitive fights if she would have been taught the right way to go about things, or at least accentuate her strengths and not feed into her weaknesses. It could have been much different for her. So it's a kind of a sad story, but a lot of times as athletes we bring these things on ourselves. But no questions asked. Rhonda and Trav are with the wrong coach, and they need to get away from him. That's my two cents on it.
There you go. All right, guys. Thank you very much. Let's know how it went down. We'd love to support the next show.
You got it. Thanks so much, guys. Really appreciate the time.
All right, guys. Take care.
Looking forward to the junkie gathering, too. It's going to be amazing.
Come on down. All right. We'd love to have you. All right. Take care. Aloha. All right, folks. That's Scott Junk, Justin McCully. Talking Mid-Pac Championships out there, a promotion that they recently founded, and they're promoting the first show tomorrow. So we'll see how it goes. There's no stream, no TV available, but hopefully they're going to move things quick and they can have things cranking by the first couple shows. We'll be right back after this break.
King Kong has a lot of shit on them. Like a lot, especially Goes. Here, Gorgeous George and Goes.
Now, where I will give Danny credit is if I was lost and he was part of the search party, he'd find me because he'd have all the coordinates down.
All the bases would be covered?
Everything would be covered. That I'll give him.
I think if this is like a survivalist show,
right?
And I go, you got to be here at this time, and Danny was in charge of that, I know the helicopter will get there.
Now, let's say I was on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, and he was my lifeline. Isn't it only like a 30-second call?
Yeah.
So I'd probably go, Danny, the topic's music. I'm on the verge of making $1 million. And now I'm down to 20 because I just said all that. Mm. 20 seconds. Then I go, Who of the Jackson 5 became the most popular singer ever? I'm just blanking. We all know it's Michael, right? And then he'd go, oh, okay, cool. Are we live or what? Yeah, we're live, man. We're down to 15 seconds. Oh, okay, cool. So you want to know who's the most popular Jack? Yeah, we're down to 10 seconds. All right, so you're talking about out of Jermaine and Tito. Click. That's it.
That'd
be
the
out.
End of it.
And then as I'm walking off stage, I'd go, oh, it was Michael. I'm such an idiot. But Danny could have assisted, but in covering all of the angles and making mm-hmm. sure everything's dialed in right, you know, I lost a million.
So they asked you who's the 36th president of the United States. Danny would say, okay, president of the United States, right? Of America would
right.
be the next one.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Danny's going to murder you, George.
He is. He's coming to the gathering. Are you coming to the gathering? What's the update?
Update is I still don't know anything.
Is one of the first things you do when you come to the gathering to kick us both in the balls?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Are you going to use that boot that they used on Roadhouse when those bad guys tried to get in?
So at this point, you guys are just hoping that I don't come. Because if I don't come, no kicks happen.
We were busting his chops during the break. All right. So it looks like I'm right. We will reissue Amir Khan to maybe tomorrow's show. He was in as of yesterday, and then there was some confusion over some timing. So the former two-time boxing champ is part of Super Fight League as an owner, and we were going to talk about what they did out there. They kind of had teams goes, and they used the point system, so they have tables, mm-hmm. or as we know them as standings. So they're now concluding their season. They have semifinals and finals, and we're just going to talk about that, and I guess the resurgence of Super Fight League. That debuted about, 5 years ago? Remember Ken Pavia was their manager and Todd Duffy fought out there? And
I'd say 5 years.
A few other fighters actually fought out there in India. I don't recall them all right now, but I know Todd did one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I actually got asked to judge. Did I ever tell you that?
Yeah.
I actually got asked to be a judge at Super Fight League, and I turned it down. For one, I always lean on our editor-in-chief, Dan Stubb, so that he can guide me and tell me what's the correct move and what isn't, you know, and I'm glad I did because you dangle money in front of me and I'm kind of in. But so what would have happened more than likely, and this is without him telling me, is when I got there, I probably would have judged as many as they needed me to. I'm not a credentialed judge, but I think I would have given them my honest call, except if there was only three of us there, I would not have wanted to be involved in the Duffy fight because Duffy lived in Vegas. And we weren't like homies or anything, but we've had lunch. He's co-hosted the show. We talk from time to time. So that would have been one where even if they forced me to do it, I'd hate to give it to him in a close fight because I know him and he's Todd Duffy. Not because he'd beat me up. I'm not scared of all that. Just because like
– you want it to come back and get you.
And if it comes back and they go, oh, it was close, but guess who knows each other? Look what Nick Lentz is going through now with Douglas Crosby and what happened to UFC 208. And then let's say I had to overreact for a close round and say, hey, look, I can prove to everyone I'm objective. I'm not going to give it to him, but yet my mind is so clouded from going back and forth of all the possibilities that I don't give him a fight that maybe I would have. It's just that I didn't want to be labeled a Duffy nut rider or his friend or – you know what I mean?
You didn't want to be Homer Simpson.
Right. And this is even without looking at who else was on the card. There was other fighters that used to fight there. One of them was Professor X. What'd they call him? Xavier?
Wait. Oh, wow.
I think he was going to fight. Yeah, a few other names that were recognizable. And so I didn't want to have a manager say, man, we could really use this win, you know, and good thing we got you here, and you get that shoulder up.
Oh, God.
So, yeah, and thinking it through, I just thought it just doesn't make sense. Even though I know I would have sat down thinking, call it as you see them. Hopefully there's finishes. Hopefully there's massacre rounds that I can make 10-8s, 10-9s, and we'll just get the hell out of here. Everybody, you know, does well. I just knew that there might be a tough spot there, and so, yeah, I backed out of it. But I've always wanted to judge an event, and now, 5-6 years later, I have to respect that seed enough to know that I would need to go at least do a training course with McCarthy or Dean and
to judge?
See more of that. Yeah, because 6-7 years ago, I mean, we're still finding our way through this job and what our exact position is, and we thought we were just zany radio hosts, you know, that would squeeze a horn when you cracked a good joke or hit a soundbite or doing whatever, you know. And as the sport grew and our website grew and our responsibilities and maturity grew, you know, obviously there's certain things we probably don't do now that we did then. Things we say now that we didn't or did then and don't say now. And So now I think it'd be one of those where if somebody told me, hey, look, we are going to have this on the opposite end of the world with no one you know, but we trust you, you know, mm-hmm. I'd be proud of myself because I think we've built up a good reputation for ourselves. So I would feel like whatever they're paying me, they're getting it in return for calling straight fights. But now knowing more about the judging and just, you know, respecting that position, I would want to be briefed by John McCarthy over a weekend, you know, one of those seminars he does, or her being. I still want to do it, honestly. I actually asked Goes when we were going to go to Bellator a few months ago, Chael and Tito, the next day they were going to have something. Remember we were talking about possibly going in there and checking it out? Now, I'm not sure. It was ABC, and I'm not sure what was going to be discussed then. I could probably find it in an email, but I think they were going to cover a lot of the changes that were upcoming and things like that, so. Let's get to some calls, though, because we're going to talk to Chris Weidman in a sec, and we do have to get one more commercial in. So we'll start off with our overseas friend, Ben, from New Zealand. What's up, Ben?
Yeah, I'm good as gold, lads. I'll make this quick. I've got three quick points, and I'll lay them out, and you guys can answer whatever you want. The first, I reckon that JDS is the correct challenger for Stipe. There was talk for a little while that Kane might have got this shot, but there's no one in that top eight at heavyweight that had more than like a one win streak. It was sort of a ridiculous situation. But Junior's win was over Ben Wathrow, who was on like a four win streak. And Kane's win was only over Travis, who's, you know, Travis Brown's been on it down, I think his last four, he was only 2-2. So I support that decision to give it to JDS. And also, of course, he had that win over Stipe.
It is JDS. They're fighting at UFC 211 on early part of May. The co-main event is Fabricio Werdum versus Ben Rothwell. So it's set. It is JDS and Stipe.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm just saying that I support that, and I think it was the right call. The second thing was a couple of days ago when talking about the Max versus Aldo fight being in Brazil. Gigi, you made a comment, and I tweeted at you about this, along the lines that Aldo gets a lot of these kind of breaks, which seemed a little bit weird to me, since this is going to be like Aldo's 11th title fight, but it'll only be his fourth defense in Brazil. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like in the entire history of the UFC, there's only been, I think, one North American champion who's fought overseas to defend the title, while guys like Aldo and Anderson Jr. and Amanda Nunes, they give up home advantage either every single time or the vast majority of the time. So it's good for Aldo to fight in Brazil, but it's still a rare thing for him. It's only his fourth out of 11 defenses, you know?
Yeah, but it would be three of his last six. I guess, I suppose you're right. From what I call, that comment I made, I didn't base it off too much off facts. I just based it off this feeling I have that the last 3 or 4 years, there's just been these pull out of fights where they're rescheduled and they wind up in Brazil somehow. And I think that's happened a couple times. So, you know, this one's going to happen in New York. Holloway got hurt. I guess it could have happened in Buffalo. It could have happened in Dallas and somehow it wound up in Rio. But, you know, maybe that's the UFC's call to feature Aldo there. It kind of works out for Aldo.
Sell tickets.
Holloway will be the guy that travels. But it just seems like he's caught a couple breaks there. And maybe this one wasn't his fault. But I remember one, I think it had to do with Chad and Aldo in L.A. Remember that was a card that they canceled, Goes? Mm-hmm. And I thought the injury he had wasn't that serious, and sure enough, it happened to land like 2 months later.
The late strike.
Right, exactly. So that's kind of what I was basing it on. I'm not an Aldo hater at all. I wish the great Aldo would fight more often. I mean, it's like he's a once-a-year guy on on a few of his years. Let me see. He fought once in 16, once in 15, and once in 12. So in the last 5 years, he's only fought once, three of the 5 years.
Yeah, you're 100% correct about that Mendez fight that was scheduled for the U.S. and got rescheduled in Brazil. But both of his previous Brazil fights were scheduled in Brazil the whole time. Not only that, one of his American title fights was originally supposed to be in Brazil, but it got rescheduled into America. So he was even, like he was even in terms of that sort of stuff.
Okay.
Until his Max fight, which now he's got like two that have been rescheduled into Brazil and another one that was rescheduled from Brazil into America. So I think there's these things that come up like the and this is me white knighting for Brazilians, I think that's what this call is, but there's these things
people say that
Brazilian fighters get caught for PEDs more than Americans, when if you actually look at the numbers and do it per population, it's pretty much even. And also, we've talked about this before, that thing where people will say, well, the refereeing in Brazil is a bit dodgy, but if you look at MMA decisions, they always do these updates at the end of every year, and they put out which are the most controversial fights, and there's no evidence that there are more controversial fights in Brazil for Brazilian fighters than anywhere else. So, but to get off my Ben from New Zealand, why not for Brazilians theme, your main man, GG, Paul Felder, who I really am a fan of as well, and you've said he's one of your ride-or-die sort of guys, I think. Mm-hmm. He fights this weekend, right, against Alec Ricci.
Right.
But I haven't seen, I didn't see Ricci's only UFC fight, or I haven't seen any of his previous UFC fights, so...
He's only had
one. Do you
know
much about him, Ricci?
He's only had one, yeah. He's primarily a striker, and he does work with Robert Drysdale here on his grappling to shore that up, 34 years of age, so a little bit of a late start in the UFC, a business owner, but he's been traveling a lot, putting all that to the side, working with Angelo Reyes on his boxing. Both guys like to strike, so I think you'll see striking more than anything. He's about a 3-to-1 dog. Felder's a big favorite here. Even though Felder is one of my favorite fighters, I just love the way he's going. I'm back in Ricci. What can I say, man? We dig the guy, you know, and we believe in him, so we'll ride with him on this one. But that one was a tough one to pick. I think you went with Ricci as well, Gus?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ben, we got to move on, man. Good stuff. Good call. Thank you very much, as always. I will look into Brazilian PEDs versus American and see how all that goes down. We're going to take this quick break. When we come back, we'll talk to Chris Weidman, former UFC middleweight. Got lots to talk about with him. He's got Musasi coming up in April, and he's also going to be featured on Monday's episode of Kevin Can Wait, CBS.
They taught Andy Griffith how to whistle. Here are Gorgeous George and Goes.
All right, folks, on Monday at 8 p.m. Eastern and Pacific, another episode of Kevin Can Wait on Twitter, at Kevin Can Wait CBS. It'll be the return of Police Officer Nick, played by Chris Weidman. He will be featured in this episode along with our good friend Boss Rudin. And joining us now is former UFC middleweight and part-time actor Chris Weidman. What's up, Chris? How you doing?
What's going on, guys? Thanks for having me.
All right. Thanks for coming back. The return of Police That's Officer Nick on Monday. Can't wait to see it. Wanted to ask you, when was this filmed, and in any way did it interrupt, I guess, your fighting career? Because I know the days on the set can be long sometimes.
We just actually filmed it. We filmed it last week. It was a like a Monday to Friday thing, but like Monday, it was from like 11 to 12, and we're done.
That's not bad.
You know, it wasn't really that hard, and I was able to get my training kind of in between all the filming, because it's literally 10 minutes away from my gym where we're filming, so it's real convenient.
What's more nerve-wracking? When they say, you know, take two, and next thing you know, you guys are filming, and you know a lot of people are depending on you to hit your lines and, you know, be where you need to be, or then bright lights and you have to walk out of that tunnel to face another human being that wants to do bad things to you.
You know, as nerve-wracking as acting is, you know, my first time acting was on the Kevin Can Wait. Well, my first time really acting in front of a lot of people was on the Kevin Can Wait show. The first episode I was on with Adam Sandler and Kevin James, and that was pretty nerve-wracking to be on set for my first time with those two, like Hall of Fame actors, pretty much. You know, so that was nerve-wracking, but it can't compare to walking out for a fight. That's another level of nerves, I think.
Definitely, you know. You've been friends with Kevin James for a few years now. Did you whisper in his ear, hey, I'd love to try it? Or did he come to you? Like, who came to who as far as you being a part of this?
He came to me. It wasn't, I was friends with him. We live around each other. I think we have similar mindsets. He's very competitive, and we just get along really well. And the acting thing was something I was kind of getting into, and he had an opening for me, and he put me in there, and it worked out, and had a great time. Acting was something I was thinking, you know, maybe it's something I could translate over to and still make some decent money after I'm done fighting. But I didn't know if I was really passionate about it. But after being on his show and hanging around with those guys and getting the taste of acting, now I really do love it. It's a lot of fun. It's way more fun than I thought it was going to be.
Former UFC middleweight Chris Weidman joining us here on MMA Junkie Radio. He returns as Police Officer Nick on this Monday's episode of Kevin Can Wait, starring Kevin James. It'll also feature Boss Rudin as Rutger, the neighbor.
Oh, yeah.
And this will air at 8 p.m. Eastern and Pacific on CBS. The name of the episode is Neighborhood Watch, so make sure you tape it so you can watch it over and over again and see how these guys do. All right, Goes, what do you have for Chris?
Chris, if they were to tell you, we know what your role is here on this show, but if they created a role for you and told you, you know, pick, what would you like to play? What would be the role that you would want?
On Kevin's show?
Yeah, or in general. Is there ever like a role you've wanted to play?
I'd say my ultimate role that I'd want to play is Superman. That would be a dream come true. And the role they gave me on the show is pretty much similar to Superman. I'm really good at everything, so I can't. I'm pretty happy with the part I have on this show. I can't really ask anything more than that. But if I was to really go overboard, I'd ask for Superman.
What if you get a call from Kevin James and says, "Look, man, they changed the script. You have a on screen kiss, but we're not going to tell you who it is. Who are you hoping? Give me a couple celebrities that you go, man. I hope she's there when I get there."
Yeah, it's just acting. No one can trip.
Oh, come on. I'm a married man. What are you trying to do? Get me casted?
It's just acting. No one can trip.
Absolutely not. My wife. If my wife could be an actor, I would take that every day, all day long.
All right. Well, listen, let me show you how it's done, Kevin. I have a girlfriend. She lives with me, and she listens to the show, but I'm still going to answer the question. Goes. Line me up with, I think Jessica Alba would be a good one.
Yeah?
Yeah, you know.
We got so much taste. I'll give you that.
Man, I'd be screwing up that take over and over.
All right, Chris
that
Weidman.
Gabba's been hitting me up like consistently on Instagram, and I've been trying to avoid her at all costs. But, yeah, it's been a little awkward. My wife doesn't like her anymore.
I hear you, man. All right. So, Chris, listen, man.
You don't believe me?
Oh, no. We believe you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right.
Now, let's transition, obviously, because you are mid-camp in a big fight versus Gegard Mousasi at UFC 210 coming up here in April. I guess, you know, man, everything went so right in your career up until these last couple of losses. So we talked to you after your first loss. You felt like there was some adjustments. And then, obviously, Romero comes in. It was his night. I mean, where do you stand right now? Talk to us, media and your fans. You know, like, how do you rebound from this? And how's the camp going towards getting a W and getting back in the mix?
You know, I feel like I'm the best in the world, and I have an opportunity to show that again. And this fight with Mousasi is a perfect guy to fight. He's a guy who's on a nice win streak. He's been around for a long time. He's a 4-5 win streak. He's some good guys. You know, he feels like he's ready to fight for the title, and I'm going to stop that and put myself right into this fight for the title again. Mm-hmm. When I'm on all cylinders, I don't think any of these guys can hang with me, and so I just got to get in there and be prepared, and I'm going to make it look easy.
In a tough, after that tough loss, I'm going to steal a question that goes as asked fighters before, and I love the question. Who's been there to pick you up, whether it be a coach, a family member, you know, if you've ever had any doubts, or someone that can just motivate you to remind you of the beast you know you once were and that you can still be?
You know, listen, at the end of the day, you know, losing is part of life and every aspect of life. So I didn't hang my head very long, you know, just ran to a post-fight press conference. You know, it's part of the sport. It's the reason why people love this sport is because you never know what's going to happen. And sometimes you're on the winning side, sometimes you're on the losing side. But you can't let that change your mindset and, how hard you work. And I haven't lost anything in these last 2 losses. You know, it hasn't set me back mentally, physically. I've improved over the last couple of years, and even though I've lost a lot of fights, there's a new and improved Chris Weidman coming out, and I'm just in my prime now, and I'm going to start showing that. I'll be showing that in this next fight and the fight to come.
Chris, when you get back up to the top of that mountain, does it matter who's holding the belt at that time? Is there a particular person that you're hoping is holding it?
No, nope. Don't care. I just want to become the best in the world, prove I'm the best in the world, and whoever's up there, I'm taking the belt.
There you have it, folks. That's Chris Weidman fighting at UFC 210 versus Gegard Mousasi. But first, tune in on Monday at 8 Eastern and Pacific on CBS for the episode of Neighborhood Watch, starring Kevin James in Kevin Can Wait, and also guest starring Chris Weidman and UFC Hall of Famer Boss Rudin. Should be a good one. Chris, thanks as always for the time. We appreciate it. Good luck with the rest of your camp. Break a leg on Monday's episode, and hopefully we'll talk to you soon on Fight Week.
Thanks so much, guys. I appreciate it.
All right. Take care. We'll see you.
All right. Bye.
All right, folks. That's Chris Weidman. First of all, I want to thank Kelly from CBS and Zach from Paradigm for making that happen. Amir Khan has contacted us, and we will have him on tomorrow's show. Tomorrow's show will be hosted by Rob Cardenas. We'll also have Boss Rudin on the show, and Amir Khan, and working on one more name. I want to thank today's guests, Cheick Kongo, Justin McCully, and Chris Weidman. Danny, great job as always. Goes, you were a 9.5 out of 10. I, of course, took it to another level. I was fantastic. I do have to say that. So this is our chance to do some quick plugs. Goes and I can be followed on Twitter and Instagram at MMAJunkieGeorge for me, at The Goes for Goes. Our radio show is the same, at MMAJunkieRadio on both. And as far as Facebook's concerned, I have a Facebook. It's facebook.com/GorgeousGeorge. The radio show is also facebook.com/MMAJunkieRadio. Danny the producer is the lead singer of a band called Automatic 253. Danny, where do you want people to follow you on your social media across the board?
Across the board, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, it's at Automatic 253.
There you go. All right, folks, we'll see you tomorrow. Go Man U, and the rest of you, go out there and be champions.
very last dime. If my wind up broke, will I?